Monsters have preoccupied mankind from the earliest times. Even cave art includes animal-human monsters. Certainly monsters were present in the ancient religions of Egypt and Mesopotamia. The Old Testament describes the giant land and sea monsters of Behemoth and Leviathan. While in the world of classical mythology, monsters embody the fantasies of the gods and the cruelest punishments of human beings. While we may no longer worry about being eaten by trolls on the way home, there remains a fascination with these creatures who have shadowed us throughout history.
Artists were asked to create creatures with horrid and terrifying looks all the time in history. Many of these creatures were common in folklore, especially legends with heroes and princesses. Some were hybrid creatures and not so ugly after all, and sometimes they might have proved to be helpful rather than frightening creatures. For instance, take Jean-Auguste Dominique Ingres, who painted the Christian soldier Ruggiero riding on a hippogriff while saving the pagan princess Angelica. And if I recall correctly, a very similar hippogriff called Buckbeak is featured in the movie Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban.
Everyone has a different idea what a monster is. I mean, they're really different ideas and different conceptions and different rules.
I think it's here now.
In truth, monsters only represent in flesh and blood what scares people, what keeps them awake at night, what makes their nightmares so weird and spine-chilling, what makes them wake up screaming in the morning.
It's interesting what you consider a monster. And what do people fear? I mean, some people just fear bees or ants. You know, so what do the movies do? They make giant bees, and gargantuan ants, or snakes. And people are just afraid of snake.
Monsters represent evil. And in Western culture, the leader of all evil creatures is, of course, Satan, the devil. We can find many devils in art, but there is a couple I like very much. I think Carlo Crivelli did an excellent job with his green Satan. It looks like the Renaissance version of a Rick Baker creation. In general, reptiles and coal black creatures were all considered to be associates of the devil. And these include dragons. Dragons were demonic creatures before being treasure guardians such as Smaug in The Hobbit. Their favorite food is often a young princess, and you need brave soldiers such as Paolo Cello's St. George to tame these animals. This beast looks like the basilisk in The Witcher Season 2 finale, but in Uccello's painting, wounded by St. George and bleeding, the dragon is no longer a threat. And the princess's girdle can be used now like a dog's lead. It's a powerful visual metaphor to explain that the devil, the evil, never dies, but we can keep it under control. Often monsters go hand in hand with black magic, like Salvatore Rosa's witches at their incantations. Two bare-breasted witches riding from the woods on skeletal and monstrous beasts. It's pretty hard to work out these monsters' anatomy. Pretty much like the first Alien movie, where you can't really tell what the monster looks like until the very end of the film. We fear the most what we can't see and understand. Likewise, it's unclear what these witches are really up to. One uses a wax mannequin and a mirror to divine possibly a lover or a future victim, but similar mannequins were commonly used by artists. Rosa might have used wax mannequins to create this very picture and proudly signed his name on the nearby rock. Wow, that's very cool. It looks like the painter is telling us that every time we see monsters, that might be a nightmare, that might be black magic, all, most likely, we are simply under the spell of some very skillful artist. Monsters are creatures living in the darkest places of our minds. They represent the dark side of our soul and imagination.
In 1954, movie audiences were alerted to a new cinematic presence, a deadly creature whose popularity would soon rival that of Dracula and the Frankenstein creature. The creature from the Black Lagoon went through several revisions in the Universal Studios makeup department. The final Gilman was developed by department head Bud Westmore and veteran makeup artist Jackie Vann. But dozens of talented individuals worked on the costume that would be worn by a 25-year-old actor named Ben Chapman. The creature costume was actually a one-piece body stocking over which thick foam rubber body parts were glued.
The look of the creature was created by Millicent Patrick. She was a gal that worked over at Universal and did a lot of designs for different films and stuff. And she actually came up with this little fella here. I think it was kind of her dream child. She loved him. It looked exactly like her sketches.
Creature from the Black Lagoon was the movie that kept audiences out of the water for years to come. And just when its power began to wane, just when viewers thought it was safe to go back in the water, something far more real rose from the depths.
Well, this is not a boat accident.
This shark, swallow you whole.
You open the beaches on the 4th of July, it's like ringing the dinner bell.
You got any better suggestions?
Why I love Jaws is that it uses the template of a film, you know, a monster movie from the 50s, such as Creature from the Black Lagoon, and amplifies it. It amplifies the horror, it amplifies the gore, it amplifies all of these things that maybe they couldn't show in the 50s that they could, by the time it got to the 70s, they could show it.
This is no legend.
This was no boat accident.
What was that?
It was a shark.
Something out there.
There's something else out there.
Some entirely different form of life.
An eating machine.
We didn't come here to fight with monsters.
And then I think the main reason why this film is lauded as well is because basically the shark was crap.
So they tested the shark for the first time in the water, and we had at least 20 boats of tourists who had gathered around an area to watch the shark work. And we had the shark on a huge 90-foot platform 30 feet underwater, and at the press of a hydraulic button and pulling a lever back, supposedly the shark comes shooting out of the water head first. And this has absolutely happened because David Brown and Dick Zanuck were there watching with me. The shark came up tail first. It just came up tail first, and it was like it was like a 25-foot moon.
Because you're seeing parts of the shark, it makes it scarier. It doesn't matter about civilization, you know, or in the water. It doesn't matter about what's going on around it. Its aim is to feed.
Everyone knows the shock of swimming and feeling something brush your legs. It scares the hell out of you. It's that fear of the unknown that makes these films so primordial and timeless.
You son of a... That ought to do the trick.
Spielberg said that his love of sci-fi sprang from being curious about the stars and space travel, and having a semi-unhappy childhood looking for escape. The enormous success of Jaws put him in a position where he was a bankable proposition to make a film of his choice, and he made Close Encounters of the Third Kind. This man is the Italian longtime professor of fine arts and special effects master, Carlo Rambaldi, who designed and created the classic-looking extraterrestrial for the film.
This is the model of the Close Encounter.
mechanical part and this is the structural part.
Some of the animatronic puppets were built by Rambaldi, whilst 50 of the aliens were played by 6-year-old female ballet students. In 1979, Ridley Scott directed Alien. The production gave a new opportunity to Rambaldi beside H.R. Giger.
There are also tubes from an old Rolls-Royce, from vertebrates, from snakes, and it was a mixture from everything together, was built up together with plasticine that doesn't shrink much, and so it holds, you can put things together normally, it's not possible.
Gordon Carroll, one of the three producers, but the main producer on the movie, brought in Carlo Rambaldi, done Close Encounters. They brought him in to actually put Giger's designs into practice. So there were several attempts before Rambaldi was brought on at quite a lot of, over the budget, unfortunately, to do it. But my God, it did work from then on.
When we do see the fully formed creature, the xenomorph, it is just, it's just terror. But then you see the teeth, it's just absolutely horrendous. It's just a horrible, horrible thing.
I asked to Ridley, why are you shooting very little of Alien? And Ridley said, Carlo, the audience have terror when they don't see nothing. When see the dark area, because expecting the monster possible here, and this is maximum the level of the suspense. I say, no, it's good. I shoot this little, Carlo, be quiet. Your movie, your monster, people saw, but very little.
Oh, my
God.
What is the best movie monster ever created? Which one is the scariest creature? We might first think of the Predator, or the Xenomorph and Alien franchise, or the Thing created by Stan Winston, or perhaps the T-Rex from Jurassic Park.
One of my favourite monsters, and he is a complete movie monster, is the Dummy Hugo from the 1945 British film Dead of Night. The character Maxwell Freer, who is the ventriloquist, has either suffered a complete psychotic break and is imagining that his dummy is actually speaking to him, or Hugo, the dummy, is possessed. What is wonderful about the film is that you're never quite sure which it is. And that, for me, is the epitome of horror.
But my favorite is Bartolo Bermejo's devil. Look, chicken legs but with claws. Big smile, but it's a piranha smile. Shiny golden armor, but it's not tonight. Around his elbows are the heads of living snakes, and the breastplate displays bloodshot eyes. A mouth with sharp metal teeth opens on his belly. I think H.R. Giger might have wanted to make this creature.
For over 120 years, the global film industry has created thousands of nightmare-inducing creatures. We've just seen some brilliantly designed monsters in well-directed movies.
But also just not only thank you guys, but also obviously the incredible team of creature and makeup.
But these creatures would not work on the screen just because of their look. That would not be enough to scare us, or even take them seriously. They have to look dangerous. The creators need to build up the suspense, atmosphere and fear on the screen. We have to care about the main characters, otherwise they just do not work.
Honestly, I don't want to speak too soon, really, but I really think she might be the one. I do.
That is
so great. She sounds amazing, Chris.
She is. I can't wait. She should be here any minute. She had to get an Uber. There's a problem with her car. Mm.
Oh, all right. No, no.
Oh, my God. Here she is.
I'll get it. You take all a right, breath.
Okay. Oh, my.
Oh. Guys, this is Emma.
Perhaps the scariest creatures remain in our own imaginations. The empty spaceship where nobody can hear us screaming, or the unknown vastness of space, or a simple dark room, a place where we do not have control, or something which can be very human, but also strangely different. Probably the scariest monsters have always lived in our minds. The fear of the unknown is so ancient. This feeling has been with us since humans started to use their brains and they were hiding in caves. Or maybe I'm wrong, and the answer is the creature from the Black Lagoon. You're simply the best.